Bismillah, walhamdulillah, and Allah's blessings, mercy, and forgiveness be on all of His prophets. We do not make any difference between them all. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. In this first installment about the hadith, we're going to deal with the story of the hadith, how it reached the point it has reached today. Because any believer who ever listened to any sheikh speaking, you certainly have heard the term, it is the hadith says or the sunnah says. So you, the listener, what does the term hadith mean to you, specifically to you? When someone says the hadith says or the sunnah is this or that, what do these terminologies mean to you, specifically you? Well, in this first installment, we'll take a small journey into history to see how this hadith matter got all started. Why is it called hadith and sunnah after all? Why someone would say to you the hadith says or the sunnah say, and how do you interpret that and how do you act upon that? How much weight do these two terms, hadith and sunnah, widely spread today, how much weight do they have in Allah's religion? And if the hadith and sunnah were part of Islam, why hasn't Allah spoken about them clearly and explicitly so that not to leave any doubt for anyone that reads the Qur'an? Because hardly ever you turn a page in Allah's Qur'an, the book of Allah, without Allah condemning the disbelievers or hypocrites or disobedient Muslims on not following the words of Allah. The Qur'an is full, as I said, it's in every page of Al-Qur'an. In a way or another, Allah talks about the Qur'an. If the hadith is part of the legislative system in Islam, why then did Allah say that His religion was completed when the messenger was alive? In normal circumstances, Allah would have first revealed all the Qur'an and all the hadiths collected and the messenger is alive. Then the messenger would approve of the hadiths and then Allah would reveal, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم, today I have perfected your religion for you, وأتممت عليكم نعمتي, and I have completed my gift upon you, ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا, and I have chosen الإسلام, and I am pleased with that as your religion, the way of life that you're gonna lead. Well, the Islam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed, which was in the Hajjat al-Wada' in year 10, the last Hajj of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the previous ayah that I read, where Allah says, I have perfected your religion for you, completed my gift on you, and have chosen al-Islam, that was at that time when the Messenger was alive, as the lifestyle and the religion for us, all this took place 90 days before the Messenger of Allah left earth and died. Because 90 days after that, there was no halal, no haram, no do's and don'ts. It's finished. The Quran was closed 90 days, give and take few days, prior to the messenger death. So did Allah say something that He didn't mean? Why did Allah reveal this ayah, as I said, only 90 days before the messenger's death? Because, as I said, after this ayah, Allah never legislated anything halal or haram or made any extra laws that weren't at the time of the messenger before those 90 days. Well, again, this is a question that needs to be answered. If the hadith was part of Allah's Islam, then why didn't Allah instruct us about it before closing the Quran and stamp it with His final ayah, like today, let's say, the ayah that I've read, that Islam is completed and Allah has given His bounties to us and everything. And why our man of religion, and I always mean the sheikh, scholars, and etc., insist on teaching that Al-Qur'an, the hadith, which is the matter of unteachability. It's unteachable hadith. Why do they insist on teaching the unteachable about the hadith till it became not only equal to the Qur'an, but it superseded the Qur'an. Because, as I said before, in the Salafi sects, in the books that they have written, they say that a hadith can abrogate, can actually render the meaning of Al-Qur'an to zero, and the hadith takes precedence. And this is absolutely incredible. What they mean by this is that in the Qur'an, there are some ayat that are there in the Qur'an only for reading purposes. They mean nothing, and they actually have no significance whatsoever. Why is that? Because, well, the hadith has abrogated them. These are difficult times that we live in. If you ever have the opportunity to ask a sheikh or scholar, whoever, about the hadith and how the predecessors dealt with it and why is it the way it is, the contradictions and everything, the sheikh A is going to get angry with you, and if he doesn't, then he's going to withhold himself, because you have spoken about a matter that is not open for discussion. Because in their belief, the Salaf or the predecessors, the righteous predecessors, are people whose integrity, loyalty, knowledge are indisputable. You cannot talk about that. And they will tell you that these, the Salaf, have done everything in their powers to keep this Islam true, as if Allah is not doing a job good enough that we have to put our hands in and protect al-Islam. However, there is one question that sticks out. If our righteous predecessors did such a great job, who turned a 4 months Hajj into 5 days Hajj? Allah insists in the Quran that Hajj can take place in any 4 months. But the Salaf said, nope, Hajj is only 5 days once in a year. And that day is Dhul Hijjah. You all know. When Allah says in the Quran, Al-Hajj Ashhurun Ma'lumat, Hajj is in well-known months. And this is in Surah Al-Baqarah. Why is it then the great scholars and the righteous predecessors, such Malik and Ahmad ibn Hanbal and few others, they said, as it is mentioned in Ibn Kathir and Al-Tabari and few other books of hadith, why did they say that the Hajj can be performed in 4 months throughout the year? For example, Malik, who is the founder of the Maliki school of thought, and Abu Hanifa, the founder of the Hanafi school of thought, and Ahmed ibn Hanbal, the founder of the Hanbali school of thought. And this, the last one, the Hanbali school of thought, is widely followed in Saudi Arabia. Okay, and it's strictly and religiously followed in Saudi Arabia in these days, in our present days, okay? And also for the last 1100 years. There is also Ishaq ibn Rahawi, a well-respected scholar of hadith and one of the teachers of al-Bukhari and Muslim and many other collectors of hadith. And also did Ibrahim al-Nakhai and all these people, and al-Imam al-Thawri and Layth ibn Sa'd and many, many more. I know these names mean nothing to you, but if somebody from the Salafi sect listens to my talk, they know I'm not bringing some Shia or some weird sheikhs. No, I'm bringing the heads, the stars, the superstars of the Salafi sect, or what they call the righteous predecessors. So why do all these great scholars say that according to this ayah, what Allah says, Al-Hajju Ashhurun Ma'lumat, that Hajj is in well-known months, why do they say that Hajj can be undertaken any time throughout the year, exactly like the people when they go to Umrah? You can go to Umrah any time of the year, right? Well, our scholars, the ones I've named, they say you can go to Hajj any time of the year. And they mentioned, of course, other couple ayahs to support their arguments, which I'm not going to mention them now. I'll deal with that, inshallah, when I deal with the Hajj subject altogether. Okay? Now, all of these scholars said that you can perform Hajj throughout the year. Now, comes a Shafi'i, the fourth or somebody of one of the four school of thought, a Shafi'i didn't agree with the whole year opinion. But he said that Hajj is to be performed as instructed in this ayah in the 4 months of Hajj, because Allah says that in iddat ash-shuhur indallah ithnat ashara shahr, that the number of months with Allah are 12 months. Amongst those 12 months are the four sacred months. So Shafi'i says that Hajj can take place in any of these 4 months. Okay, so this, you can read a lot about this in Tafsir Ibn Kathir. He even mentioned a few hadiths which support the argument that Hajj is to be undertaken in 4 months. Here is an example of such hadith. Okay, Abdullah ibn Abbas mentioned that anyone going to Hajj must make their ihram only in the months of Hajj, and I emphasize the S. And then it says, it is part of the Sunnah to observe ihram only in the months of Hajj. And this hadith is authenticated by Ibn Kathir in Sahih Ibn Khuzaymah. It's just like Sahih Bukhari, this is another book of narrations. Ibn Kathir said that when a companion says it is part of the Sunnah, it means only one thing, and that is the companion doesn't speak out of his own mind, but rather he has heard it from the messenger and is only relaying it to us. Now, apart from the hadith, anyone who looks in the books of hadith and tafsirs of the Quran, etc., will find that our scholars of the Salaf, or the righteous predecessors, all unanimously agree that the months of Hajj are at least four. And then they disagreed on when these months are. Now, the question is, if our righteous predecessors, who came in the 3rd century, 300 years after the death of the messenger, messed up in which months Hajj can be performed, why should we trust them with anything else? Because some of them, they say, the months of Hajj are Shawwal, because right after we finish Ramadan, that is the beginning of the months of Shawwal, of Hajj. They say it's Shawwal, Dhul Qa'dah, and the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. Already? No. So again, this is one saying. As soon as Ramadan finishes, the months of Hajj, the first of the second day after Eid, is the beginning of the months of Hajj until you get to Dhul Hijjah. And the other group said, no. It is Dhul Qa'dah, Dhul Hijjah, Muharram, and Safar. A third group says, no. It is Dhul Hijjah, Muharram, Safar, and Rabi' al Awwal. That's why at the beginning, Malik, Abu Hanifa, and Ahmed ibn Hanbal, Ishaq ibn Marahawi, Al-Layth, and all these people, why did they say it's throughout the year? Because they could not resolve the conflict. Because when you look at the conflict, it's absolutely the whole year. So they, even though they all unanimously agreed that the Hajj period is within a defined set of months, they just couldn't get which months. These are months, my brothers and sisters. This is not a woman wearing perfume, she's cursed. These are, it's something that people should not have messed up. But they have. That's why today we perform Hajj only in Dhul Hijjah, 5 days, and that's it, and you go Hajj. And then we ended up inventing some things that Allah didn't mention in Al-Quran. So if this is the case of Hajj, for Hajj, okay, how about Ramadan, Salat, Wudu, Zakat, Laylatul Qadr, marriage, divorce, how we get married, women, and everything? Because all these things have been messed up to a huge deal by our men of religion. They have made a big, messy mess of Allah's perfect religion that exists in the Quran. And they cannot go back on their footsteps. They cannot acknowledge the scholars of today, in our time now, they cannot acknowledge that those who came before us had messed it up. Many books throughout the time and the eras and all these things have been written. Almost each era has got an author or two who wrote about how the hadith got started and how it was documented. By all these historians and the sheikhs and always say what was going on at that time. Now, just to say something, I have 4 kittens and they keep running, so if you hear something banging here and there, it's my kittens making the noise, okay? So let's carry on. So when the men of religion write about a topic or a subject, they always have an angle. And that angle is always around one of the following points. History. Take a sheikh, for example, in Saudi Arabia. If he writes something, he will have to take in consideration the history. They don't want to make the people that came before us, the righteous predecessors of the past, They don't want to make them seem as if those people have made an error and a big mistake. They want to keep them holy as possible. We say we don't have saints in our Islam, but we treat everyone from the righteous predecessors as one. That's one, history. Two, the sheikh has to take the politics into considerations, because whatever the king or the crown prince or the governor or the head of the army says becomes a religion, and then the job of the sheikhs will just be to find evidences from the books of the hadith. They can also twist the ayah to mean what the king wants. And you can see that in modern Saudi Arabia. Subhanallah. Jamal Khashoggi, again a journalist that was brutally and violently assassinated in Turkey. Guess what? It's a murder. The entire world agrees it's a vicious, heinous, and terrible and horrible murder, right? Except in Saudi Arabia, the sheikhs have found a legal justification as to why the government could kill Jamal Khashoggi, and what the government has done is the correct thing. It's incredible. Even the Sheikh Sudais, I pray to Allah to give him what he deserves, in khutbah in Jummah has praised the crown prince. It's incredible what our sheikhs do in the name of Islam, against Islam. Anyhow, the third point that the sheikh has to carry in mind is the school of thoughts. And this is, it's the Game of Thrones at best, or Star Wars at worst. And in between these two worlds of the Game of Thrones and Star Wars, there is World War One and World War Two and Three and all that kind of stuff. And the battle rages on. What one school of thought considers halal, the other school of thought would go in the opposite direction and say, no, it is haram. This is incredible. They make the Quran seem like it's the most idiotic book out there, because people will say, oh, Islam, which one should we go, right? Or this one says halal, the other one says haram. And the sheikh then, on the fourth point, will take the personal agendas. And that is, if one sheikh doesn't like the other sheikh, he will do his best not to say the same thing as the other one. Or he will deliberately say something that contradicts the other sheikh. Why? Just because he doesn't like the other sheikh. So it's history, politics, school of thought, and personal agenda. This formula has not changed until our times. And people, you and me, are confused today. The world of hadith and sunnah is a minefield. It's full of confusions. Because they always believe that no matter what the fatwa is, some other sheikh will come up with the opposite. And this is the state of the believers today. We believe that even in divorce, someone divorces 100%, they will look for another sheikh that will tell them, no, your divorce is invalid. And it happens all the time. But was it always like this? Well, in the early days of Islam, at the beginning of Islam, from Mecca times till the death of the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and decades later, the term hadith was unknown to people. For hundreds of years, the term hadith and sunnah was unknown to people. They didn't know something. When they tell you that the companion said hadith, it's a lie. That is what the people in the 3rd century wrote. But at the time of the companions, they didn't have something called a hadith or sunnah for that matter. The terms used were al-athar, which is a trace, and they will even today, some sheikhs would define themselves as an athari. For example, if you go Islam QA and you look about Al-Munajjad, he will say, I am an athari. Athari means he follows the traces. In other words, what's known today as hadith. But they called it a trace, or al-khabar, the information. The closer people were to the messenger, the extremely cautious they were at inventing terms. However, the term hadith was coined later on the 3rd Hijri century, with the coming of a scholar of hadith, such as Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmidhi, Abu Dawud, etc., and Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and so on and so forth, okay? But that led to troublesome times, because after the death of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the only text in authority was Allah's book, the Qur'an, and the Qur'an only. There are tons of hadith that mention this, but our sheikhs and men of religion always keep them away from the public. The companions understood that the Qur'an was the sole authority. The Qur'an was the sole and the only source from which they took whatever they needed. And it was for them the only evidence. And that is what they ever requested, and that is what they ever provided. What does Allah say in the Qur'an, they would ask. And then one of them would answer. None of the companions ever asked, what did the Messenger of Allah say in a hadith? What's the sunnah in that? Such a request was never an option for them, and things stayed that way until 35 years from the Prophet's migration. That is 25 years since his death. Because, you know, Rasulullah ﷺ migrated, and then they started counting the Hijri year from his migration. And that is also another headache that has led us to this wrong calendars that we have today. Only in the Muslim world, in our believers' world, that spring, Rabi'ul Awwal, the beginning of spring comes in December, like in winter, because we have something wrong in the way we calculate time. But that is this is a talk for another day. But at the time, the problem started in year 25, i.e. 25 years since the death of the messenger, and that is exactly when the civil war broke between the companions, between Ali and Muawiyah. And this happened after the assassination of Uthman, the third president of the Muslim or the believers state. When the civil war happened, it took 5 years to finish. The civil war ended with the assassination of Ali in year 41 Hijri times. But the repercussions of that are still alive today with us. After the assassination of Ali, Muawiyah stole power from Al-Hasan, the grandchild of the messenger. And since that, Muawiyah then switched the whole thing and turned it into a kingdom. He became the king, and that problem never ever ended until our times. The 14th centuries and beyond that time, the conflict still lives on. And that's why you still have the Shia today versus the Sunni, versus the Ibadi, versus the Ash'ari, versus this and versus that, and versus the Shaitan and versus Hellfire and so on. And if these people don't read the Quran, which considers divisions and sects a shirk, Allah considers believers who divide on the Quran, any group is a mushrik. But the problem is, each group says, no, we are cool. It's the others who aren't cool. It's the others who are mushriks, the others who are those who share with Allah. And because of that, we are in a huge, big problem. Because as far as Allah is concerned, the equation is simple. One God plus one book plus one messenger equals one religion. Example, in England, we have one highway code, we have one nation, we have one set of roads, we all drive the same, we follow the same laws, right? Well, we don't have different sects in driving in England. Someone says, oh, this group drives like that, that group drives like that. We all follow one highway code. But that's not the case when it comes to Al-Quran. All these groups are divided because they are not following the Quran. And this, I am willing to put my hand in fire for it. Now, during the civil war, each party tried to prove its legitimacy to power. And since the Quran is a closed platform for manipulation, they couldn't use the text of the Quran to boost their ratings. So what did they resort to? Well, they resorted to a very mischievous act. And that act was, the Messenger of Allah said, and the Messenger of Allah told me, and the Messenger of Allah did. Now, the more a narrator is closer to the messenger, the more authentic is his or her version of the hadith. For example, there are so many hadith where the narrator says something. Needless to say that the hadith manufacturers were scholars, well-versed scholars. They had to be very knowledgeable in Arabic, and also they had to have a great memory and also a great line techniques to mention the chain of narrators, because once they say the hadith, they will need to remember it all the time, and they need to remember their chain of narrators, and they started documenting this. They started putting down their lives in writing to go back to when they need that. Now, all of them, as I said, were well versed in biographies to know who was good and who was not good. They had to know who from the narrators can be accepted without any arguments. Then came one hadith that is in al-Bukhari. Oh, that is Ammar ibn Yasir, the killing of Ammar ibn Yasir. All of you have heard of the hadith that Ammar ibn Yasir will be killed by the transgressing party. And that transgressing party happened to be Muawiyah. When Muawiyah killed Ammar ibn Yasir, only then that people started seeing that Ali was correct and was right, and Muawiyah was not. But later on, as I said, Muawiyah became king and oppressed people further, even if the religious texts were against him. But Muawiyah was pushed on people and forced on people. Guess who helped Muawiyah? The men of religion, our sheikhs and our scholars. And that's what led the rest, so that each party would boost themselves with the hadith. The civil war brought the worst out of all parties, and people divided over who was more fit to rule and who wasn't. Many people had rejected Abu Bakr, but you never get to hear that. And the reason you haven't is because you are part of a sect or a group that does not allow this kind of information to travel freely on the information highway. All right? Especially the people of Al-Madinah. They did not accept Abu Bakr. The Ansar were promised by Abu Bakr and Umar a power share between them, both of them. It's kind of like Abu Bakr is the leader, and then he's going to appoint so many ministers and lords and all that kind of stuff. But Abu Bakr failed his promise, and after him did the same thing. Umar did the same thing, and that filled Al-Ansar with a lot of bitterness and despise for these two men. Some companions who opposed the leadership of Abu Bakr and Umar were assassinated later on. One of such companions was somebody called Sa'd ibn Ubadah. Sa'd ibn Ubadah was killed in al-Iraq and al-Kufa. And what do you think the reason of his death was? Well, our historians claim that this great man, Sa'd ibn Ubadah, was the leader of the two biggest tribes of Al-Madinah, Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj. These two tribes are the biggest tribes in Al-Madinah, and they are them who had supported the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they did everything to help him. But anyhow, these people lost it to Abu Bakr, and they didn't accept the manipulation to power of Abu Bakr and Umar. But what our sheikh said once Sa'd ibn Ubadah was killed in al-Kufa, in al-Iraq, they said that it is the jinn who have killed him. This theory, as ridiculous and hideous and as horrible and unbelievable as it might seem, is one of the reasons, and it is written in our books of the righteous scholars of a Salaf. And they accepted it. They accepted that idea, and until today, they accept unquestionably it's Sa'd ibn Ubadah, the big leader who did not oppose, who did oppose Umar and Abu Bakr, was assassinated by the jinn. And you know why he was assassinated? Well, here is why. Because when the messenger of Allah died, before, when the companions Abu Bakr and Umar were busy with the messenger's funerals and everything, Al-Ansar had met in some place called Saqifat Bani Sa'idah. And this is like a meeting place where people meet. The Ansar had already appointed Sa'd ibn Ubadah as the Khalifa, the successor to Rasulullah. But Sa'd ibn Ubadah on that day was extremely sick. He had a flu and a cold, and he was just sitting in a corner with a stomping and a big headache, and he was not fully there. So, you know, when you have a headache and you are just thrown on the floor. Sa'd ibn Ubadah, but they had elected him. So for a few hours, Sa'd ibn Ubadah was the Khalifa until Abu Bakr and Umar came. And after that, Abu Bakr and Umar did their whatever they did to take away the leadership from Sa'd. And after give and take, arguments after arguments, the Ansar refused Abu Bakr to be the leader. They had already appointed Sa'd ibn Ubadah. But guess what? After give and take and promises, they agreed to Abu Bakr. And Sa'd ibn Ubadah was bitter for that, and he never ever recovered from that. He didn't give his allegiance to Abu Bakr, and so many other companions refused to give allegiance to Abu Bakr. And before, when you refuse somebody, you would just leave town. And here is Sa'd ibn Ubadah, who was born in Al-Madinah, grew up in Al-Madinah, lived in Al-Madinah with the messenger, had at one point to take his clothes and leave his town to Al-Iraq. And then he was murdered in Al-Iraq, reason being he peed somewhere where the jinn lived and they killed him in retaliation. What a horrible, stupid, idiotic lie. But that is in our books of history, and that is what our people have accepted, and the hadith is authentic. It's crazy. But anyhow, to make people accept what was going on, and also to stop them from questioning those in authority, especially Muawiyah, so many hadith were invented about people by people. Here's an example. They made Abu Bakr the best man to walk earth ever. And they say, just remove the messengers, and Abu Bakr will outweigh everybody until Judgment Day. Why was this hadith invented? So that people accept the leadership of Abu Bakr. And also how he was of the people of paradise. And suddenly the messenger becomes a god, knowing what the future holds. They told us that Abu Bakr was the man who migrated with the messenger, and that he had left all his money in Mecca to serve Islam and so on and so forth. Even though the messenger was accompanied by somebody else, not Abu Bakr. The Quran says otherwise. The man who was in the cave with the messenger was not a believer and was just a guide. The man who spent all his fortune should be the one who would succeed the messenger. And they made Abu Bakr, and they made him and made him and made him till Abu Bakr became part of Al-Islam. If you do not believe in Abu Bakr, then you certainly aren't a believer. You must believe in him, in Umar, in Uthman, in Ali, in, even though Allah sent us one messenger with one book and ordered us to believe in his messengers, and that's it. But our man of religion added, if you wish to be a believer, then you must also believe in Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Muawiyah, etc. And on top of all that, you must believe that all companions are reliable and they are dignified and they are this and they are that. My dear sisters and my brothers, he was just like you and I. Abu Bakr was not a faultless man. Like all of us, he sinned and he repented. He went to the toilet, he farted, and he did everything. He has led incessant wars against people who had made different choices than what he thought was the right thing. Our historians and sheikhs were present to make his battles of Abu Bakr against other people who still were believers in Allah and his messengers and everything. But because Abu Bakr had a different political views, he crushed them all in fights. And our scholars named these wars very, very very, very mischievously, very manipulative. They call them hurub ridda, the war against the reverts to disbelief. All it was is some people that saw different than Abu Bakr, and that's why at the beginning, the majority of the companions, except Abu Bakr himself, were against his idea of war, and he kept hammering, and then he used his powers as, I am the successor of Rasulullah, and I want this war, and he got his war. The majority of the companions did not agree with him. It's incredible what our past holds and how much they have held from us. Again, say one word against Abu Bakr and you are taken out of Islam in no time. If you're not killed or if you're not accused to be a Shia, this and it's incredible, my decision. But anyhow, all this is justified because of those unsettling times and the lack of verification. People were freely throwing those. The Messenger of Allah said, the Messenger of Allah told me, the Messenger of Allah held my hand and taught me, etc. The idea of the Messenger of Allah said became the norm. Now the people needed to add, to embellish, to add some drama so that people believe more. And then a new breed of narratives, or maybe the chain of narratives came about. And you hear somebody says, the Messenger of Allah taught me while holding my hand. Abu Huraira would tell you that in Sahih Muslim that the Messenger of Allah held my hand with both of his hands. Now, in your mind, you start picturing a man holding the hand, i.e., everything is full on, like attention and everything. And what does the hadith say? In Muslim, the hadith says that Allah created the heavens and earth in 7 days. The Quran says 6, but the hadith says 7. But because Mr. Abu Huraira said that his hand was in the hands of the Messenger, our scholars could not reject this hadith. It's incredible the amount of wrong that our men of religion are doing. At that time, people were more into the Messenger of Allah said than Allah said. Why? Because the Quran doesn't have some ayah that praise Abu Bakr or Umar. But the fabrication of this text by people was full on. Anyone was happy to just formulate a hadith, oh, XYZ told me that XYZ that the Messenger said, and then they would put their hadith. The news of the Messenger of Allah said was spread around far more than the Quran itself said.